So we want to talk about the complex spirituality of Star Wars. Obviously, there's so many links. Hopefully, we'll try and make it a bit more discussional. Hopefully, I've got some answers, but I'm sure you guys have got plenty as well. So Star Wars is, of course, the story of an orphan boy who becomes a radicalized after a military strike kills his family. He's indoctrinated into an ancient religion, joins a band of rebel insurgents, and carries out a terrorist attack, killing 300,000 people. So that's what we know, that's what Star Wars is about, right? The true story of Star Wars. But we're okay with it, because they were bad people, right? That's fine. Now, we can't talk about Star Wars and religion without it kind of acknowledging like the census and sort of our geek friends who may have tried to put on, you know, Jedi as... Did anyone here put on Jedi in their census? No? Okay. But supposedly it was somewhere around kind of 0.3% of Australians put on Jedi, you know, in one of the past censuses. I checked the stats and it kind of increased for a while there, but then by about episode 3 it kind of brought things down. People kind of got annoyed at that movie and perhaps less people wanted to engage as Jedis. And so, but there is this thing worldwide of people kind of questioning, oh, whether maybe it's a real religion as well. And then, of course, the atheists kind of push back and say, actually, you're actually causing trouble because you're just adding to the religious size or the size of the religious pie by claiming Jedi as a religion. If you're not into religion, just say no, whether it is the robes of, you know, priests and pastors or whether it is the robes of Jedis. If you're not into religion, don't say it. Don't try and make up another religion. But I want to sort of ask the question of you guys, what do you think is the religion that kind of connects best with the universe of Star Wars? So a few options. So Buddhism. Do you guys see much in the way of Buddhism kind of connecting to Star Wars? Well, what do you see? What might be aspects of Buddhism that connects with Star Wars that you recognise?
Renunciation of desire.
Yep.
Disattachment.
Yep.
Balance of the force.
Balance of the force. Yep. Meditation is a key part of it all. All those sort of things. We even see Yoda. Like, it's almost kind of speaks in riddles, like we see with a Jedi master. The acting in episode 1, 2, and 3 of like the Jedis are so wooden, like they are in this kind of Zen state where they dare not have anything resembling emotion, humour, interest.
Was that a deliberate choice? Was it the acting?
No, I think so. I think it was. I'll take it as acting. Maybe it's the characters. I don't know. But it's kind of this Zen thing that they can't be moved and so there is that, and there's that kind of yin-yang. So whether the yin-yang perhaps is not actually a Buddhist thing, it's perhaps more of a Taoist, but you know, we'll take it as that kind of Chinese religion where there's this balance between good and bad, and there is like bad within the good and good within the bad, and we see it with Vader. You know, he's not all evil. There is good within him yet, that we see within that kind of way of thinking, which is kind of within that kind of Chinese Buddhist, Taoist thought. Then Hinduism. What might you connect with Hinduism and the Star Wars universe?
Light.
Yep.
The significance of light.
The significance of light, definitely. Yep.
A life force connecting all things.
Life force, yep. Yeah, they're like a unification where, you know, all religions and the Hindus can have all sorts of gods, and we've got this all-powerful force that connects with all. Yep. General Grievous is this kind of multi-armed guy that it's almost like some of the Hindu gods. Their multiple arms. You get your Hindu warriors that can kind of connect where you've got this, like it is a religion that seeks to be peaceful, but at the same time will take arms and take on their take on the power. And there's the animal gods thing as well, I almost think that some of the characters and the outfits kind of connect possibly best with Hinduism, and the real, like the colour and the flair and all of that kind of stuff that we see and that we appreciate. There's a quote here in regards to the dark side of the Force. The movie depicts the Jedi Master Yoda as saying, you know, fear is the path to the dark side. Fear leads to anger. Anger leads to hate. Hate leads to suffering. And then this reminds one of Lord Krishna's instruction to Arjuna, where he calls lust, anger, and greed the three gates to hell. So there are Hindus that will connect to Star Wars and say, oh, yeah, this is like our religion. It's like what we believe. Muslims and will connect Islam with Star Wars. Of course, like Islam sort of, you know, we might joke around about the other religions. Islam seems to have less of a sense of humour around about being joked about. But even in that, like the Force we see, you know, is not to be physically represented. You know, Allah is not to be physically represented. Don't draw Allah. You'll have issues there. Any other things from Islam that people would come to mind for them? In some research, this character, they talk about the Green Master. Al-Khidra is this kind of, one of the sort of, it's not a key character of Islam, but is one that is thought well of, and he's kind of set up in the same way that we see Yoda as the little Green Master, and we see him kind of in the swamp, and the Green Master meets at the place of two rivers and sort of teaches his disciples from there. So we see a connection there with Islam, and so yeah, it's kind of looking on the internet, like some Muslims kind of, they find their connections with Star Wars in little patches like that of like, oh yeah, this part of our story connects to Star Wars. And, you know, I'd never heard the story of their Green Master before. And obviously Christianity for us, that's kind of the rest of the talk. There's plenty for us. But of course, nearly all religions will have some kind of mentor-mentoree relationship, like, you know, that we see, like we see with Yoda and Luke, and we see it throughout sort of the hierarchy and the family tree of the Jedi's as they kind of pass on the faith. It's crucial for us, you know, when we see, you know, Moses and Joshua, or we see Timothy and Paul, and we see, you know, Jesus and Peter. We see it over and over in Scripture. But of course, we see it in Star Wars in plenty of places too. And also we acknowledge that there is nothing new under the sun, and that there's so many parts from the Star Wars universe that you kind of think he's so just, not just grabbing it from other, like what's the movie from the 30s where C-3PO is taken? Oh, what's it called?
Metropolis.
Yeah, there's not just a visual representation, but even like the stories that we see, the ancient stories like Christianity and Islam and so on. So part of George Lucas's inspiration for it all is he talks about there's a whole generation growing up with any kind of fairy tales, and kids need fairy tales. It's an important thing for society to have. And that's part of his perspective of wanting to actually have this great story, in the same way that we see J.R. Tolkien and others in the past sort of saying, yeah, Western culture, it misses our myths. We need more of this. And George Lucas kind of continues on from that. He describes in regards to his religious take in some of the interviews with him as being like the elephant, and that they're all right, but they're just hanging on to different parts of the elephant. And so that was his sort of perspective amidst it all. And it's a reasonably common sort of secular understanding. Of course, the weakness in it is because it kind of affirms everyone, but then at the same time it makes the person who knows it's the elephant the master of all, rather than the different people hanging on to different parts of the elephant kind of patronizing one another and saying, you don't understand. Actually, it's the detached person is kind of patronizing, saying, well, it's you guys that don't understand. I'm the one that can step back and be distinct. And also we know with Star Wars that, you know, Han Solo, hokey religions and ancient weapons are no match for a good blaster at your side, kid. That whole sort of, there's that balance between the Force, but then also just the science stuff. And, you know, we see that sort of going back and forth where they sort of bring together, and so we have, you know, the Jedi's, you know, deflecting the laser beams because they are so at one with the Force and so understanding of what's coming at them. So I want to show a little clip from which has George Lucas kind of talking about what's his take on some of this stuff. I'll probably first go with this one.
Definitely a place for organized religion. That's a very important part of the social fabric. And I would hate to find ourselves in a completely secular world where, you know, entertainment was passing for some kind of religious experience.
Isn't that a fascinating end line there? That I hate to see. That he's longing, he's encouraging that Star Wars would awaken a spiritual desire within people, but then kind of saying, like, I don't want people to stop there. And you kind of can see that he's not trying to set up a new religion. It's to be a fun movie and to make us think. So the question, which of the original trilogy is your favourite? So you can only vote once. I presume you've hopefully seen at least one. So whose favourite is Episode 4, A New Hope? Okay, Empire? Return of the Jedi? Oh, reasonably well spread. I would just presume it's always going to be Empire as sort of the darkest, kind of interesting one. But, like, in reality, they are all kind of important together. So I want to ask you guys, what are the connections that you see between Star Wars and Christianity?
Well, the prophecy.
Yep. Yeah, the prophecies.
Sacrifice. Yep.
Sacrifice, most certainly. We see that over and over again.
A clear distinction between good and evil.
Yeah. Yes. Mm. Yeah. Well, especially in the original three,
yes.
It does get hazier as things go along.
Yeah, for me, like Episode 8, actually, and I was watching bits and pieces of the preparation for this yesterday, it's starting to make me question about the fact, is it about good and evil, or do the Jedi represent the Pharisees and the religious order, the Sith, the absolutes and the darkness, etc., and is it somewhere in between, which is what Luke is trying to communicate to Rey about his past failings and mistakes, etc.
Yeah. And yeah, but it's certainly, yeah, you see a massive change in the most recent movies compared to just the simple, clear-cut. And because, Lucas talks about that it was meant to be cowboys and Indians in space. And, like, in the 70s and 80s, cowboys and Indians, like, cowboys were good guys. And now we wouldn't make a cowboys and Indians movie because you'd be in strife, and and you just wouldn't risk it, because you can't play them. Like, you can only have the Nazis and the Russians as the bad guys. Like, that's just probably some Arabs as well, but, like, you stick with the Nazis, everyone agrees. We're kind of in this kind of messy world where one person's terrorist and is another person's freedom fighter. Other thoughts for... Yep.
Resurrection and redemption are very closely tied together.
Yeah.
So when someone is resurrected, that has to work with redemption in them.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Just being the chosen one.
Yep. Yeah.
Love seems to feature.
Yeah, love is a big underpinning of it all. Yeah.
Use the force.
Yeah.
Yeah. Holy Spirit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's not ever done alone. It's always in.
Yeah. Yeah. Definitely.
Finding help or grace at the extremities of life when you've got nothing left.
Yeah.
Is that good will prevail even if it doesn't seem to
matter? Yep. And when there's this massive evil and it's this tiny little band of rebels, but, you know, hang in there. Yeah.
Being tested in the desert.
Yeah, there's definitely some desert connections. Yeah. Yeah. Some things that I think connect. So obviously we have the key sort of hero narrative, that for 4, 5, and 6 we have Luke as the hero. We've even got a traitor, like Lando is the traitor, like his hand gets forced. Maybe, you know. And so we see that as sort of a key thought, that Luke is the hero, but again, he's not alone. He goes with these others. And so a lot of it comes from Joseph Campbell's book, The Hero's Journey, which was fundamental in shaping the way Lucas thought. And so we see kind of the flow of the hero's journey in so many of the different movies and as a whole. We see Obi-Wan's self-sacrifice as like in episode 4 as kind of like the key thing. And it's so fascinating that he just goes and just, that's it. And it's for the sake of the others so they can escape, so that he's then with them from then onwards. It really sets the scene. There is a focus on the family, not in a James Dobson way, but as in it's the Skywalker family that we see throughout the whole thing. So I really loved the question before, who's the key character? Anakin, Luke, it's the Skywalkers in the same way that we see that we all, as in Christian story, we all trace ourselves back to Adam. That Hebrews kind of talks about, you know, the first Adam and the second Adam. That so much of the scriptural, the story of the Bible is then about the seed of Abraham. And again, so we can talk about, you know, being children of Abraham and then, of course, sons of David and then sons of Christ. And that we get adopted as sons and daughters of Christ into the family. We see redemption of Vader by love. And so there's read stuff around conversations between George Lucas and Lawrence Kasdan, who helped make the amazing Empire, but that he was kind of pushing for darker stuff and sort of a greater influence of Buddhism and that detachment. But we see in Return of the Jedi that Vader is essentially redeemed by love rather than being this kind of detached wooden Jedi or Sith character. But he does connect back in with his family. And it's fascinating to see Lawrence Kasdan kind of saying, you know, needing to kill off more of the key characters, almost in a pre-Game of Thrones kind of mindset. Where back in the day, it's like, no, key characters have to stay alive. You can kill off other ones, but not the key ones. We see it with Princess Leia that pulls out that quest of, you know, my only hope, to come and join the rebels, come and join the group. We see this is essentially the discipleship journey of Luke, that he kind of starts out as this young chump, but he needs to grow and learn from, you know, wiser Yoda. And the other thing that I kind of like in all of this, we see that there's plenty within the Star Wars area of science fiction that still does connect with the fantasy stuff we heard about before. And hearing J.R. Tolkien talk about sort of key things as he sort of writes to C.S. Lewis about key things within mythology, is that there is a desire that's within all of us to hold communion with non-human characters. And we see that in Genesis, in the garden, but we see it in Star Wars with like so many of our favourite characters are like Chewie or Ewok or Admiral Ackbar or whatever it is for you, that we love that diversity, that it's not just another human drama, but we feel really attached. And so, you know, many of us, you know, seeing Solo, like seeing where Chewie came from, it's just like, oh wow, this is just the best. I got to see that with my son, and we were really excited to see those moments of, you know, the starting of Chewie, because he's more than just a walking carpet. Like, you really feel connected to him. And that there is something within humans for that. To see that final conquest of good over evil, and that we have that exciting moment when each Death Star or equivalent blows up, of like, yeah, excellent. That's, you know, we know the good guys won again. To step outside of the boundaries of time and into another world. And again, that's that moment when the starting credits come on, it's like, yeah. Like, it's that that other place that we feel like we go to. To have a love without parting, again, you see that in the sort of the end sequences, when we see, you know, them sort of proudly there, getting their medals, and yes, like the team has won. That it's not a lone thing. It's not about Luke. It's not about Han. It's about the team and what a glorious team it is, and that they need each other in the same way that as Christians, that it's not just me, my Bible, and my podcasts, that we actually like worship as part of the church family, and that that is absolutely crucial to us, to them, to discipleship, to all that God has called us to, and ultimately that all of these mythology is this longing to escape death, and so again, end of Return of the Jedi, when we see the characters that we know and love that are still alive, that they're not just in the ground, that they're not just forgotten about and talked about occasionally, but they are alive through the Force. I'll skip that one. But so a couple of other key things that need to be mentioned when we talk about Star Wars and the Force and all that sort of stuff, that there are some significant differences. So it's not just that that they have a kind of a pre-Christ salvation similar to ours, that there are some significant differences, that the Holy Spirit, whenever the Holy Spirit is mentioned in the Bible, it is not just sort of an impersonal, detached force that's, you know, floating in the air. That the Holy Spirit is personal. The Holy Spirit dwells within us. The Holy Spirit prompts us. It's not just that we put down the thing and trying to see when to press the button. Like, it's not just an impersonal thing. That it is God speaking to our hearts, connecting with our minds. That's not just a detached thing. That the way Yoda talks about the Force and the understanding of the ultimate being God, that it's far more a pantheist sort of kind of almost like The Secret, where God is in the universe and in the traffic and in the trees, and God is trying to tell me something through the blowing of the wind, and that God is in the flowers. That's distinct from the way that the God of the Bible speaks to us. The God of the Bible creates so that we might enjoy it, but he's not just kind of in the flowers in that kind of way. That what we see within the Star Wars universe, so much like a yin and yang kind of thing, where good and bad, there's kind of flows where the good gets a bit more than the bad and the bad gets a bit more than the good, and it just kind of flows back and forth. That God and Satan are kind of equal opposites, having this kind of battle, and we really hope we've chosen the right team and that he wins in the end. Like, it's, I heard it just talked about that it is, that when we think of it in a sports analogy, it is the dream team versus my kids' basketball. Like, that there's not a comparison of like who's going to win. I really hope it's the dream team. The battle's over. You know, evil comes secondary to God. And that we see within the Force, almost kind of party trick kind of things. God doesn't work that way. And so when I was reading Psalms recently in the Message Bible, I came up with this one. I'm up against it, with no exit, bereft, left alone. I cry out, God, call out, you're my last chance, my only hope of life. I couldn't help but read that. And so obviously the Message Bible was written after 1977. So maybe Eugene Peterson is a fan and kind of puts that in there for a few of us to kind of laugh at. But it grabbed me. It's like, yes, we see that kind of that cry of Leia. We see that cry of David. And that it does point us back to Jesus, that Jesus, you are our only hope. Any other thoughts, questions, comments around Star Wars, God, faith, and more? Yep.
Use the force, the force is taken and used for the human's benefit, whereas in the Holy Spirit is using us for God's benefit.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. And essentially, like, who's the star of it? Where, yeah, God is the center of the universe, and we are his creation to bring glory back to him, as opposed to it being, oh yeah, well, I want to win this battle. Yeah. Help me see when to press the button. Definitely. No, I haven't caught up to see whether he's... But I would expect he's still in that mindset of wanting to be spiritual. I'd be shocked if he's buttoned down to one particular church kind of mentality. I would expect he would be still very kind of open. Dave?
Just maybe technicality, but it's just an interesting thing that a number of theologians now have talked about panentheism as an interesting... crossover where pantheism is all this God, all this one. Panentheism is essentially that God is bigger than, but creation exists in some sense within God. So in him we live, we move, we have our being. That in the end, God will be all in all. This sense of union with God. And there's debates over whether that is a tweak on Christianity, whether that's essentially Christianity, or guys like Jürgen Moltmann, a senior theologian, saying, I'm a panentheist, which is interesting in our age of ecology, where we notice the interconnection of all things, that there's this sensitivity now to that makes these kind of stories cling. There's a sensitivity to, well, God at times does speak through an earthquake or can speak through these things because it all coheres and is held together in Christ. So God's not nature, but God holds it all together and therefore can speak through it, and it's all connected together. So it's an interesting kind of blurring of some of the categories.
Like, I know of someone who's part of their coming to faith was seeing a shape of a cross in the clouds.
Yeah.
And that's...
Is that Constantine?
Well, no. Thankfully not. But it's that kind of thing where you see these stories of people having these strange things where nature... really speaks to them and points them to Jesus. But yeah, we want to say that the flower is, God is not in the flower.
Yeah, so it's not Eckhart Tolle, but it is, it does have a mysticism.